Welcome. It's 7:01, and because we have an inflated view of our importance, because we're webcasting, live streaming this on Facebook for probably millions of people across the world, thought we'd start. My name is John Bell. I'm the director of the Ballard Institute and Museum of Puppetry. And we are very glad that you're here for the second of our Puppet Forum series, American Puppet Modernism in the Early 20th Century, which is going to be a conversation with Steve Abrams, the editor of Puppetry Journal, the publication of the Puppeteers of America, Bart Rocco-Burton, the director of the Puppet Arts Program here at the University of Connecticut, and surprise guest, participant, Andrew Perialli, a puppeteer and poet from New Hampshire, who's also the editor of Puppetry International. So we have very high puppet geekdom here. We will geek out and nerd out about puppets in the 1930s. This is, as you can see, if you want to take one of these flyers on your way out, the other forums coming up will be Madeline Saya and Zach Broom, our puppet arts student who's in rehearsal right now. They'll be talking about She Kills Monsters, the show that they're rehearsing, going up with Connecticut Repertory Theater. And then in April, Paul Spirito will talk about his film Ancestral, which will be shown as part of that presentation. Our puppet performance series continues in March, now it's March, with I Spy Butterfly by Faye Duprat. And also, take one of these cards on the way out and tell your friends about this new exhibition that's just opened last Thursday and about which we're excited, and take some and give them to your friends. Don't mail them unless you put a postage stamp on them. And then this is a call for proposals. I put some on the back table for a project we're doing starting in October, Living Objects African American Puppetry, which is an exhibition and a festival and a symposium and an online catalog. So that, please let people know about that. This is a sign-up sheet. We ask you to sign up, put your name down if you don't mind, so we can let people know that folks actually come in person to these events. And I wanted to mention that when we were making this exhibit, we wanted to focus on American puppetry from the early 20th century. The Ballard Institute collections are very strong in that area. And so I thought, oh, we'll call it American Puppet Modernism, because there's a book by the same name that I wrote, which you can also purchase. So we're stealing stuff from that. You know probably that the Puppet Arts Program is the oldest and unique program of its kind in the United States for the over 50 years, offering master's, MFA, MA degrees, and undergraduate degrees. And then the sister program is the Ballard Institute and Museum of Puppetry, where you are this evening. Steve Abrams is a puppeteer and a writer, and comes from a dance background, actually. He's a veritable font of information about puppetry. Andrew Perialli also is a puppeteer, and as I mentioned, a poet based in New Hampshire, which I already mentioned, and has been the editor of Puppetry International since its beginnings, which is over many years.
We first started putting out issues in 94, and before that, it was a smaller format magazine called Apropos, and we began producing that in 85, so yeah, it's been like 33 years.
Oh my gosh. And Andrew's wife, Bonnie, it does the design. Welcome. That's Tom back there. And Bart Rocco-Burton, who's been heading the Puppet Arts Program for 25 years, a puppeteer and inspiration to many generations of puppeteers around the world, in fact. So we're here to talk about puppetry and modernism. What is puppetry? Oh, that's a big question. What is modernism? Well, when we talked about this, Steve said, he had a somewhat different definition of modernism or approach to modernism, which he will explain, talk about. And I was thinking, in terms of what we're bringing here to the exhibit on the other side of the wall, a kind of broad definition of modernism as a combination of different aspects of 20th century culture, modern life, in which traditional forms in puppetry, for example, like marionettes and hand puppets that come from European sources in the United States contexts, traditional forms find themselves in new contexts of life in the United States. So people doing marionettes might be traveling around the country in trucks or cars with trailers, using the highway system and traveling far more than their European forebears would have done from Maine to California and back. People performing traditional marionette shows might do so in the context of a film like Jerry Pulls the Strings, where almost a dozen puppeteers would create a spectacle of marionettes for the American Can Company about the history of coffee that would be shown at the 1939 World's Fair. In addition to those new uses for traditional forms, you'll find people like Tony Sarg, who's a kind of thread throughout, inventing new forms of puppetry in addition to the marionettes he's doing. For example, inflatable, I think they call them reverse marionettes, inflatable giant figures for the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. So new technology. So old forms of puppetry are being complemented by new forms of puppetry. Old traditional puppets are being used in the context of new technologies like film and television starting in the late 30s. Puppets are being used for advertising. Puppets are, for example, in Hazel Rollins' work, are the part of mass production of objects for education for kids as well as entertainment. Puppets play a role in political performance, political ideas in the 1930s in responses to the Depression and to the rise of fascism, the America First movement in Europe, which a lot of people were opposed to because of Mussolini and Hitler. And then you have examples of very new ideas about objects in motion that someone like Alexander Calder does for the 1936 production of Socrat over in Hartford at the Wadsworth Athenaeum. And as Steve is going to mention, Calder is over in Paris in the 20s making a tiny circus puppet show with wire figures and watching all sorts of inspiring Europeans do stuff. So we thought that I would start first to talk a little bit more about this in terms of attention to the situation of women in puppetry. Then Steve's going to talk about modernism in puppetry and include a focus on Europe. Andrew Perialli has been doing a lot of work on a particular company called the Turnabout Theater in LA, which started out as the Yale Puppeteers, three gay men who had a very successful theater in the 1930s. And Bart is going to be a respondent and have brilliant responses and questions to all of this. So, and then we would like to invite you to be part of these conversations as well, okay? So I thought I'd start talking about women in American puppet modernism because it's such, because not just because March is Women's Month, but because women play such an important role in the situation of puppetry. So I put together some images, and the first one is of a guy, Tony Sarg, who comes to the U.S. He's born in Guatemala, he's from a German family. he watches European, British marionettes and brings that technique over. But he works with a lot of different puppeteers and, as I mentioned earlier, trains a lot of puppeteers who work with him in his many different multiple companies. People like Hedy Louise Mick and Ellen Van Valkenburgh, who I'm going to mention in a minute. Hedy Louise Mick and Valkenburgh came from the Chicago Little Theater, which is the first of these, I would say, the Little Theater movement, which is an avant-garde arts movement that brings to bear the work of playwrights like Eugene O'Neill, who's sort of seen as the first real artistic art theater playwright in the United States, the first great American playwright. And he's part of a movement with the Provincetown Playhouse that's totally into puppets as well. That Little Theater movement begins in Chicago with Ellen Van Valkenburgh, comes from a relatively wealthy family in Chicago, meets this guy, Maurice Brown, is from Britain. They're inspired by Edward Gordon Craig to say, puppets, maybe they could be part of these ideas we have about making art theater, making performances, making theater that's not simply commercial, but that aspires to the same kind of artistic ideals that we see being pursued by Ibsen and Chekhov and Stanislavski and Maurice Maeterlinck and Edward Gordon Craig and all these people in beginning the late 19th century in England. So they start this little theater, Chicago Little Theater, in Chicago as part of it's kind of an elite, upper middle class interest in making art theater. And they focus first on Shakespeare plays or scenes from Shakespeare plays and perform them with marionettes. They're also doing live performances with actors, but we're thinking about the Shakespeare plays here. And Valkenburgh invents the term puppeteer. She's trying to think of a way to define the women. It's mostly women who she's working with doing the marionette operations. And the term has not been invented, so she decides, thinking of the word muleteer as someone who drives mules, she thinks of puppeteer as someone who does that work with marionettes. So here's some random clippings of what the Chicago Little Theater was doing, and the type of theater includes pantomime, which is a visual theater form that it's not puppetry per se, but it's definitely not realistic actors' theater. And the puppets that she used for Midsummer Night's Dream, the Rude Mechanicals, are here in her production of scenes from Midsummer Night's Dream. And if everybody could read this very quickly. No. In a way, it's just the title that's interesting. Puppeteering as fine art, you know, the fact she invents the term puppeteer, but the idea that puppetry is not simply a low culture street performance form or an entertainment for children, but a fine art, that's kind of key to this moment of awakening sense of puppetry in the States. And these are some photos of some Chicago Little Theater productions with puppets. And also, one of the more imagistic types of abstract theater that were part of these experiments, which to my mind are part of a whole approach to theater that involves visual theater, objects, masks, and of course, puppets. So going back to Tony Sarg, we mentioned earlier that Valkenburgh and Hedy Louise Mick, who was more of a writer, I think, helped Sarg with a production called The Rose and the Ring after a pantomime by the British writer Thackeray. They went out to New York to help him figure out some aspects of that. And as I mentioned, many different puppeteers worked with Sarg and then went out on their own. For example, Margot Skuas and Rufus Rose, often referred to as Rufus and Margot Rose, but we'll refer to them as Margot and Rufus Rose. The company was called Rufus Rose Marionettes, but as Bart Rocker Burton said, you know, Margot was kind of responsible for most of it, but it was the 30s and so the guy. So Margot and Rufus were performing with one of Tony Sarg's multiple traveling companies. We have very nice letters, kind of love letters in our archives of Margot, who was in Italy studying sculpting, writing to Rufus, who was on tour in Chicago with a puppeteer named Bill Baird, and it's a lot of gossip, which I'd like to go into right now. And they did shows like Treasure Island, which Sarg had done, but they did their own shows very early. They got involved in film, this film called that I mentioned, that they did for the American Can Company, Jerry Pulls the Strings, and they moved to Connecticut. This is their home in Waterford, Connecticut, and very famously, they designed the home so that the garage, which I think is where this door is now, would turn into the backstage of a marionette theater for which the audience would sit in their living room. So they did marionette shows in their house. They got in the 50s, moving ahead in time, they worked for NBC doing Howdy Doody. They did the puppets for this very famous television show called Howdy. How many people have heard of Howdy Doody? Okay, thank you. But some younger people might not have heard of that classic form. This is kind of just the return of the repressed. And another Midwest little theater movement effort was the Cleveland Playhouse, which is still in existence, and it was started by a guy named Raymond O'Neill, who was, like many of these people, an enthusiast of Edward Gordon Craig, this crazy act. He wasn't crazy. Well, people thought he was crazy. He was an actor and a designer. Eccentric, definitely. And he thought puppetry was really awesome, and puppets were better than actors, which didn't endear him to actors, and he still doesn't. But anyway, his many writings and his zines and his publications, which interestingly he managed to distribute all around the world, which is really smart. Pardon? Edward Gordon Craig, C-R-A-I-G. He inspired all of these different people. Van Volkenburg and Brown, for example, went to France to have an audience with Craig, to sit at his feet and learn, you know, from the master. And he would sort of famously be abrupt and not listen, not talk to people. He was very he didn't have good social skills. But the Cleveland Playhouse, which O'Neill was interested in, Cleveland, Ohio. Started, and like the Chicago Little Theater, they were doing plays with actors, but they also did a marionette show. So, for example, they did Helen Hayman Joseph's versions of William Butler Yeats' plays, The Shadowy Waters, and a show she invented, The Life of Chopin. So Helen Hayman Joseph continues to be a major player in puppetry. And Yeats and his colleague Lady Gregory had started the Abbey Theatre in Dublin, and that was one of the inspirations for this whole little theatre movement. And Yeats had written no plays that were done with masks and marionettes and sets by this guy Edward Gordon Craig. So there are all these overlapping influences that Bart says we should put together in a big diagram that will be very confusing. The Midwest is very key to this movement. Chicago, Ohio, Michigan, as we will see, Detroit, Indiana. This does not start in New York City or on the West Coast. This all starts in the Midwest, so that's very interesting. Marjorie Batchelder, who's from Ohio, which goes to college in Ohio State University, her puppets for the birds are right out there. She's inspired by all of this stuff going on, and at Ohio State University, she focuses on puppets. She does her basically her, I think her master's project as this show you see out there, Aristophanes, the birds, right? Puppetry as art, the birds. It's a legitimate kind of show. And starts writing books, Rod Puppets and the Human Theater, the Puppetry Handbook. She's involved with her later husband, Paul McFarlane, in inventing the Puppeteers of America. So, and she does this Maurice Maeterlinck symbolist play, The Death of Tintagiles, which was a kind of classic non-realistic symbolist play. And that's another version of it. Here she is with Rod Puppets. Rod Puppets, she's writing notes are from South Asia. The origin of the Rod Puppets, as she sees it, is with Javanese Wayang Golek. So this influence of Asian puppets is very strong in American puppetry at this moment, at this time. Rod Puppets, shadow puppets from China, Bunraku theater from Japan, this multicultural global culture sense comes very early in the world of puppetry. Martin and Olga Stevens are from Indiana, and they, as you can see here, are doing marionette shows mostly. We have a Mark Antony puppet by them on display of, as you can see, pretty serious stuff. The Passion Play, Joan of Arc, The Nativity, Cleopatra. Here's Martin Stevens. I don't know. Why don't I have a picture of Olga? Making a puppet for Jerry Pulls the Strings, which brought together Martin and Olga Stevens, Rufus and Margot Rose, Bill and Evelyn Baird, and a variety of other women, mostly puppeteers, to make that film, some of the puppets of which we have right there. The Neighborhood Playhouse is a little theater in New York City, and it's sponsored by Alice Lewison. She and her sister Irene started the Neighborhood Playhouse, and that's a home for a lot of avant-garde work, including puppet shows by Tony Sarg and other puppeteers. And why did I mention this? The Provincetown Players, just because it's there, and I forgot to cut it. But Susan Glasspell, O'Neill and playwright named Susan Glasspell are the main playwrights out of the Provincetown Playhouse, and Glasspell is seen as kind of pioneering woman playwright of coming out of the Provincetown Playhouse, but she didn't do puppets. But I digress. Pauline Benton starts doing Chinese shadow theater in the 30s. A lot of Chinese shadow sets that are coming into the United States, and she starts to perform them. She has a whole company in the 1930s. She gets extensively involved in performing Chinese shadow theater, mostly based in New York. I threw this together at the last minute, so we're going back to Martin and Olga Stevens for some reason. Ellen and Romaine Proctor had a base in Illinois, actually not far from Alton, Illinois, where Frank Ballard, our namesake, was born. And they had a theater, an old movie theater that they turned into a puppet theater, and they did their own productions of shows like Jack and the Beanstalk. So there are a number of these couples who perform puppet shows. Sue Hastings studied with Tony Sarg and went out on her own. She had a lot of multiple companies. She was an impresaria, an entrepreneur of puppetry. She had multiple companies she was the largest and most active marionette organization in the country, as opposed to the Rufus and Margot Rose, which were the finest marionette theater in the world. And these are some of her puppets: Sue Hastings, her cousin Jessie. Hazel Rollins also studied a little bit with Sarg. She was from Kansas City, Missouri, and she started mass producing puppets for education. There's this idea that puppets are good for children's education emerged at the time. And it's kind of different than, sometimes I think that the puppets like we sell for kids are like entertaining, like soft, cuddly folk man's hand puppets or marionettes. And this, the idea here was really about education. This will help the development of the child to have a sense of the world, the different cultures in the world. So she invented the, she started producing marionettes. As you can see, she patented a lot of her techniques. She married a guy named Rollins, who was a mechanical engineer, and he invented assembly line production systems like that were being used for the Ford Motor Company to mass-produce marionettes. Very successful, big entrepreneur, very successful businesswoman, employing a lot of different people to build these puppets. One of the projects that women are involved with is the Federal Theater Project, which after, when the Depression started, employed lots of puppeteers. Sometimes I think it was most of the puppeteers in the United States who were getting jobs, although not the Turnabout Theater, because they were strongly independent. And thinking of Rollins, this idea of puppetry and education and therapy develops at this time. This is a more modern book by Judith O'Hare and Matthew Bernier. But a lot of women in their nurturing role are involved with puppetry. The Junior League, a women's organization, has puppet elements. They're here in the central Connecticut area. I guess we're in northeastern Connecticut, but in the Hartford area, the Connecticut Opera Guild had groups of women who would go around performing puppet shows for kids. So I think women were involved in a lot of amateur theatricals with puppets. Someone like Marjorie Batchelder, who's right here in this photo, was very involved with her husband, Paul McFarlane, and there's Tony Sarg right there, and a lot of these people we've just mentioned, in starting organizations like Puppeteers of America, which is the organization that Stevens Journal represents. And they had the first puppet festival in Detroit in 1936, and that led to the founding of Puppeteers of America a year or two later. So Batchelder was a writer like McFarlane and really involved in the development of knowledge about writing about proselytizing for for puppetry. One of the things that is interesting about the moment is avant-gardists like the writer Gertrude Stein runs into a puppeteer named Donald Vestal, who's working for the Federal Theater Project in Chicago. And Vestal is like, oh, I'm so into modern art, and I'm in Chicago, which is really boring. And here you are, Gertrude Stein's walking down Michigan Avenue. Gertrude Stein, I think there should be a puppet show based on your writings. And if you know, Gertrude Stein is this very abstract modernist, contemporary of James Joyce, but far more abstract than like Ulysses. And Stein says, of course, you know, of course, because she's got that perspective. What would be more natural than to have a puppet show based on my writing? Please go do it. And so he does, and he does this show, Identity, or I Am I Because My Little Dog Knows Me, which is about the separation of identity and sort of the psychological writing and, you know, there's Gertrude Stein number one and number two because our psyches are split, you know. And so Vestal and his colleagues create this show that they perform at that first festival in 1936. Very avant-garde in the context of and in complementing other shows like this, the Martin and Olga Stevens show, I think they did Joan of Arc, another much more mainstream fare. In terms of exhibitions, I wanted to mention Jane Heap, who is a writer, starts out in Chicago. The Little Review is the magazine she edits, and it's inspired by the Little Theater in Chicago. So she and her partner, Margaret Anderson, are editors of the Little Review. It's very famous in New York for publishing James Joyce's Ulysses, which was banned. The Supreme Court, there was a famous case about Ulysses because it was pornographic. But she was hanging out in Paris with Brancusi and Tristan Tzara, and here she is, Jane Heap and her partner, there's Jane Heap and Margaret Anderson, and she's hanging out with a Paris Dadaist, I think that's her right there, Ezra Pound, all of these folks, And then she goes back to New York and she wants to have an exhibition, an American version of an exhibition that happened in Paris and other places in Europe of modern stage design. And a lot of the modern stage design in Europe at the time, with the Bauhaus and the Futurism and the Constructivism and the Paris experience, is like awash with puppets and masks and performing objects. So she brings all of that to New York City, which is a huge inspiration and sort of jumpstarts American avant-garde theater design. So anyway, and then she publishes the catalog for that in the Little Review. So those are just some of the women who played a very important role in the development of puppetry in the United States in this early modernist period. Thank you for your attention. I wonder if you should hold that, you know, until we're, if you don't mind.
Yes, may I respond?
Oh, well, yeah, please. And then Steve says we should entertain your question, too.
I'll make it fast. I just wondered, the whole Midwestern scene, why was it so strong? Was it the immigrant patterns? Was it the lack of, being in the center of the country and not close to the stronger theater, other kinds of theater, or why?
I don't know. I've tried to figure it out, and I don't quite know why. I think part of it has to do with, maybe it's like you're saying, that maybe it's possible for new ideas about theater to emerge there, because there isn't such a strong theater structure the way there is in New York, maybe. Maybe it has to do, I think of Detroit as the innovator of modern manufacturing techniques, like that was able to happen. There was a strong arts and crafts movement in Detroit. I'm really not quite sure why, but it seems like the Midwest was open to different ideas. I really don't know why. I'm not smart enough.
I think part of it was the distance away from New York, because in the latter part of the 1800s and early 1900s, the theatrical syndicates controlled theater in this country. And it was basically Broadway productions that were being sent out to established houses, the Schuberts would be a good example, who were hiring the shows that were coming out of New York. So the art theater movement, the little theater movement, is in response to these theatrical syndicates. We need something other than commercial theater. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so the influence of the people that John is talking about comes from a reaction to that. And I think their distance from New York City leads the Midwest to be fertile for this to happen. A couple of things that I'd like to respond to that John was saying, and actually that was one of them. But the period that we're talking about right now is the defining period of American puppetry. Okay, prior to this, it was European influence. Granted, there was indigenous puppetry and mask work, but like so much of their culture, it was either ignored or crushed by the colonists and the others.
Minstrel shows.
Minstrel shows also come in a big way, but that's 1800s. Let's have another forum on that, because I teach that in trends. another thing that needs to be considered at this moment is that child labor laws are changing, okay? Children are not allowed to work in the factories for 18 hours a day. And so they have kids that need to be dealt with. So the little theater movement embraces that, and they start developing puppetry for children. You know, it's the puppetry that was performed in the 1800s was fine for families, but it wasn't specifically children. They were looking for adult audiences who could pay the ticket price. So we need to consider child labor laws, which then brings us into puppetry for education. Mm-hmm. And what's interesting is that an immigrant group in Lower East Manhattan, the Sicilian marionettes were being performed in Lower East Manhattan. And school boards started bringing young immigrant children to the Sicilian marionette shows that were performing the stories of Charlemagne, and they started realizing that the children were opening up to the understanding of history. because they were being introduced to these marionette shows. So puppetry for education, like the Hazels that John was just mentioning, becomes rather important. The one other note I have here is Margot Rufus's house, the living room actually sat 150 people.
Steve?
I'll do a quick response too. I agree with you guys totally that the Midwest produced a lot of American puppetry, and it happened in the 30s. I'm the first editor of Puppetry Journal that's from the East Coast. And so I'll try to hold up the honor of the East Coast a little bit, because although there was, I agree completely that all these great artists, and actually Rufus and Margot were from the Midwest, but then
right.
settled in Connecticut.
Right.
Well, Rufus is from Connecticut. I'm
right.
sorry.
That's right. Right. Margot was from
right.
yeah. And Bill Baird, but a lot of them ended up in New York. Bill Baird, who was from the Midwest, ended up in New York. Sue Hastings, Tony Sarn did his work in New York. And I want to throw in, especially for Women's History Month, another one, New Yorker, who's not very well known. There was a woman named Dorothy Zakonik, who founded a company in the 30s called Suzari. And the ancestor, the great-great-grandchild of Suzari still exists in Brooklyn. Nick Coppola runs a theater in Park Slope, and he worked with Suzari. Dorothy Zakonik was this little Jewish girl from Brooklyn, who around the 1930s, she's about 20, 21, tells her parents she wants to study wood carving. She wants to carve marionettes. That's pretty bold for a Jewish girl from Brooklyn. And then she tells her parents she wants to go to Europe because that's where the really interesting puppets are. And she wants to seek out a man in Vienna named Richard Techner, who had a huge, huge following. And so against her parents' wishes, she goes to Europe in 1930-31, which is right about when Hitler is starting to do his rise to power. And on her own, she travels to Prague. She performs in Prague. And she actually leaves because things are getting kind of heated up there, and she doesn't really think it's safe. But it's just amazing to me that a young woman, in that era would go off to Europe by herself and then come back. So, as usual, John is a very good person for getting people to think. And when he asked me to be on this panel, I started thinking about public modernism. And I said, well, what do you mean by modernism? And I started turning it over this way and that way. And there's a lot of facets, a lot of ways that this can be looked at. And I was also asking, well, what's going to be in the exhibit? So, at that point, they didn't actually know who they were going to be able to borrow everything from. So I tried to think of what might be in the exhibit and then what might not be in the exhibit. So some of my slides and so on are from the European influences. So here's our So I'm kind of a geek about dates and birth dates and things like this. So I put together first some modernist dates. And there's the first modernist painting is by Picasso, 1907. And it occurred to me, so there's a Spaniard in Paris. The first really modern piece of music is Rite of Spring, which is 1913. And that's a Russian in Paris. And the first, maybe not the first, but definitely an important modernist piece of literature was Ulysses, first published in 1918 by an Irish guy in Paris. Paris was kind of where it was happening. It's where modernism was really born and where those ideas came from, just like the Renaissance came up from Florence. It was just really clear that that's where that all came from. So modernism really does have its roots in Paris. And then I got off onto some birthdays. I don't know if you can read all of these, but Tony Sarg and Picasso were born within a year of each other. And Stravinsky, these were all people who were actually, this is the Victorian era, the 1880s. They were brought up, they were born in the late Victorian era and grew up with those Victorian attitudes. And modernism, especially in the 30s, was seen as really kind of an act of rebellion. They were all grounded in those very, very traditional arts, and they were very consciously rejecting them. And in those days, it was like really important. Lines were drawn. Were you a communist? Were you a fascist? Were you a modernist? Or were you old-fashioned? And in art schools from 1940, 1950, 1960, certain things became dirty words, like realism. It's like, realism is for, you don't need to paint realistically anymore. We have photographs. So let's simplify. Let's just make art based on circles and squares and very simplified shapes. We don't have to do this inherited tradition of very, very finely crafted painting or very, very finely crafted sculpture. We're going to do something that's clearly different than all that. And so in art school, ornament became a dirty word in art school. Teachers would get mad at you. Pretty was out. There was a rejection of anything that was called pretty. That was Victorian, and that was almost became an insulting word. So in a sense, some of these fairy tale puppet shows in the tradition that Sard did his, you know, he did Robin Hood, his puppets were still very much in the European tradition of carved, very beautifully crafted, carved, realistic figures, beautifully costumed, beautiful sets. And in that sense, I can't really say, I think in the 30s, much more so, the isms aren't as important now, but I don't think in the 30s they would have essentially be considered modernist. Although John pointed out quite correctly that Sard did do some things that were modernist. So the first slide that I have of puppets is what could be more 30s than Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. And these puppets are by Rufus and Margaret Rogers. And I guess you could say some people took this idea of modernism and it was a doctrine. It was either you were or you weren't. And other artists said, oh, this is another interesting way to create art. I can choose to do it this way or I can do something traditional. I don't have to throw out the baby with the bathwater. I can do something much, a little more traditional, a little more realistic, a little, if you want, pretty. Or I can choose to be more minimalist, more pared down, and more modern. And I think Rufus and Margot were puppeteers who sort of saw both sides of that. They would do things that are rather realistic, like these. But I mean, to me, these figures are timeless. The ism almost doesn't apply to them. They're just very, very beautiful puppets. I also went back to, I have a book in my library from 1937, so that anything that is in that book is from that era. And there is no question about when it was from. And of course, the pictures in that are not all black and white. The first really major puppeteer to be known to millions and millions of Americans was Edgar Bergen. And oddly enough, it was on the radio. We couldn't see his figure, but he came on the radio in 1937, I believe it was the year. Maybe 36, and his show was an enormous hit on the radio. And people had an idea of what it looked like because he was also in films. So this is a guy who was in puppetry for maybe 20 minutes, actually maybe 6 years. His name is not very well known, but that's definitely modernist. Even the title is Dadaist. The title is Z739. This was in the very first issue of the very first puppetry publication in 1930. And a very interesting character, but didn't have much influence in puppetry down the road. But I thought I'd just throw it in there because it is so very clearly modernist. Also, this series is from the 1938 book by Cyril Beaumont. So this one's from the UK. Also, clearly modernist. I have no idea who this person is. I rediscovered her when I went back to look at that book. I don't know anything about her. Richard Teschner was working, and he was really from the Art Nouveau era. He was working in Vienna, so this is a black and white from that book, and here's a color version of one of his puppets. So this is not from the oldie, worldy, Czech, beautifully sculpted type of puppet. This is a very, very different. Leger, contemporary for Picasso, did these guys. This is one of the earliest truly modernist puppets that I could this is rather modernist to my eye too, because it's such a very, very simple shape. And John and I wrote, I had a chance to see these from 1917, these Cubist costumes that Picasso made, and I wrote that they were puppet-like to try to keep the people quiet who might argue that they weren't really puppets, they were costumes. Now, to me, they were costumes, and John says, yes, they're definitely puppets, they're not costumes, they're puppets. I agree with John, I think these are puppets, and that's quite an early day, 1917. And it was actually also, that was the year the term for this particular ballet, the term surrealism was first coined. So when you compare those to these by Tony Sard, this is why I'm saying, I think it's kind of a stretch to maybe label Sard as a modernist when you compare this to what Picasso was doing. But John correctly pointed out that Tony Sard did shadow films. And this is starting to look a little modernist. This is 1920. And this is that same guy who did those more traditional looking puppets. And then whether it be because of expediency or the material he was working with, he did these balloons. And John is absolutely correct. They certainly look modernist to me. More so than the staged marionettes that he used. So thank you for stretching my definition. So I realized that all of these puppeteers ended up in Paris in the late 20s. And there's a couple that I didn't put on the list. Helen Hayman Joseph, who John just mentioned, Paul McFarlane, Alexander Calder, who was an American. Yale puppeteers, Bill Baird. I don't know if Margot Rose got to Paris, but she was certainly in Rome. I would think she would have gone to Paris. And Rema Bufano, who I will talk about in just a minute. That's almost all the first puppeteers, the founders of American puppetry, who sort of did their, they were in their late 20s. Boy, what a time to be in Paris. So Calder you could consider Calder the first performance artist. He made these little toys of a circus, and he performed with them. And he was a big bear of a man. He really did look like a bear, and he would get down and he would work these little toys to animate these objects. The circus belongs to the Whitney Museum in New York, and this is his camel. So there were, again, back to Paris, another woman, Alexandra Exter, another Russian in Paris, did these for a film in the 1920s, the Cubist Marionettes. Now, one of my favorites and John's favorites, 1931. That's modernist, no question about it. And the music is Stravinsky, that's modernist. The choice of music also has something to do with whether a show is modernist or not, I think. This is a particularly challenging piece of music. And Rema Bufano, who we were talking about, the immigrants, he began his career around the age of 20 in New York City, working for a settlement house that worked with Italian immigrants. And so he grew up with the Sicilian marionettes. That was a sort of natural for him. And he did his first sort of Sicilian marionette performance around the age of 20 at a settlement house in Greenwich Village. And his career went on from there. He did Master Peter's puppet show, the puppet opera by Manuel de Falla. He did a version of that in the 20s. And it was so well known, actually, that when Garcia Lorca came to New York, Lorca knew about it and looked up Bufano. He came to see Bufano.
Cool.
And so this was these are about 10 feet. It was done with Leopold Stokowski and the Philadelphia Orchestra. It premiered in Philadelphia, and then it came up to New York. And I don't know, how many of those survived? These are the ones that are in Detroit. There's four of them, and the Columbia University also holds several of these puppets. Oh, and Upholding New York, although Paul McFarlane was very proud of being from Michigan, McFarlane went to Columbia and did his first puppetry in New York when he was studying at Columbia, and actually spent a lot of his life in New York City. So Bufano has more Broadway credits than any other puppeteer. He was not only involved as a puppeteer, here, but he designed masks, and he himself performed. And he was, there were three avant-garde theaters in New York in 1920, the Provincetown Playhouse, the Neighborhood Playhouse, and the Washington Square Players. Bufano was involved with all three. He was right there with the Provincetown Players when Emperor Jones was first performed in 1920. He was hanging out with all those artists in Greenwich Village. And they all knew him and they kind of worked with each other. So in 1935, he did a show, I think Dumbo is Irving Berlin. I'm not sure it was Irving Berlin. But he did a huge, huge puppet for the show Dumbo, which was on Broadway. He specialized in large puppets. That's kind of what put him on the map. But he did everything. He did hand puppets, he did marionettes, he did huge figures. He even went out to the West Coast and did some work for a Fred Astaire film, but I think most of that stuff ended up on the cutting room floor. He's given a credit in the titles of the film, but you only see a couple of puppets in the very beginning of it. I think this might be from one of the Master Peter puppet shows characters. And then there was a very great actress named Eva LeGallien who worked in the 30s in New York. And she was very much anti-commercial theater. She was like theater for the people. And she did a very famous production of Alice in Wonderland, and guess who did the puppets for that? Remo Bufano. His credits go all the way up to the 1940s. He was actually in the original production of On the Town, which was the music by Leonard Bernstein. So his span and his contacts go from 1920 Eugene O'Neill to Leonard Bernstein. And he was head of the WPA in New York. And this is one of the most famous puppet shows that never happened. This is a very famous Czech piece having to do with robots. And I love this poster. And just as this was going to happen, there was a big scandal, the funding was cut, and he quit in a huff, and RUR never happened. There are rehearsal photos of it, and there weren't a lot of puppets in it. It was mask. He did a lot. Another mask that he did. It was a show in 1933, Irving Berlin, called 1,000's Cheer, and it was done in the form of newspaper vignettes. And there was a section that had to do with cartoons. He did the masks for the cartoons for his 1,000's Cheer. Ethel Waters was in that show, and she did a song called Supper Time, which dealt with the subject of lynching. And it was one of the first, it's a very, very powerful, moving song. And it was one of the first times when that issue had been put on a Broadway stage. And there was Remo Bufano part of that, too. There weren't any puppets in it, but there were masks. The WPA is amazing. It's one of the first times when our government subsidized, gasp, artists. Federal funding for the arts. Can you imagine such a thing? And the shows were at a lot of levels. Some of them were real artistic, but some of them were educational. And they did puppetry on things like good nutrition. So they had vegetable puppets. There were modern dance productions that were sponsored about venereal disease. They did all kinds of things, called the Dance of the Spirochetes. There's a famous poster of that, too. But these are WPA vegetable puppets from the 30s. And this is a WPA company that was mostly African-American puppeteers in Buffalo, New York. Now, another modernist was Ralph Chassez, who was on the other coast. He was in San Francisco. And you can look at this very, very stylized Hamlet. I think this dates from 1928. I don't know if it's the same Hamlet or not.
It's a different one.
Yeah.
But
they look pretty similar. The face looks pretty similar out in the exhibit.
Out there. And
Ralph Chassez contributed to the WPA murals as well. John showed us this very same Batchelder slide. The puppets out in the exhibit are marionettes, but one of the most important things that Marjorie Batchelder did was she helped introduce the rod puppet to this country. And this was the one that did it. She did this. 36 or 37, but it was the first time a lot of these marionette artists had seen very high level rod puppetry. And she was actually inspired by a book written by a Russian woman. And that's what inspired her to do these rod puppets. And so in a way you could say these are the great, 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 great grandmother and grandfather of the Muppets. Because before that, rod puppets were pretty much unknown. And she did her work right on into the 50s and into the 60s, and she was very interested in educational puppetry and using found objects for puppetry and getting teachers to use puppets. And the one in the upper right there is in the Ballard collection. It's in the main case, yeah.
It's a plaster. It's very interesting.
Now, Andrew and I were talking about whether the Yale puppeteers were modernist or not. See, to my eye, those are not modernist puppets. That's out of the traditional sculpted tradition from America and from Europe. And maybe one of the most avant-garde things about the Yale puppeteers was it was three men, and people didn't make statements and didn't come out publicly to say that they were gay, but these three men lived together, shared a house together, and there was pretty much no doubt about it. They were as open as I guess you could be in those days. Herman Brown actually wrote a book under a pseudonym, and it was one of the first pieces of gay literature that didn't end with suicides and tragedy. It actually put LGBT issues in a positive light. And of course, his songs are very witty and very, very up to date and very adult. So in that sense, I guess you could say that we're modern. Here they are, and I mean, this picture says it all. I mean, these are gay guys, you know. you want to jump in here?
I'll show a little more about them, but I'll augment.
Okay. And John already mentioned Martin and Olga Stevens, who did all their early work was serious theater meant for adults, like the Scottish play. And you can see that's a highly stylized. Not so much in the Sard tradition. John mentioned Hazel. So this is a woman who started a puppet factory in the middle of the Depression and made a success out of it. Keep in mind, these were very difficult times in the 1930s. I just love this man's work. This is a Russian who came to America, Basil Milovsov. Oh, I'm going to get the accent wrong.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. Modernist, I would say. Lou Bunin studied with Diego Rivera in Mexico City and then came, after a little time as an apprentice, really, to Rivera in Mexico City, came to New York in the 30s. And there's some of his puppets in the exhibit as well. Now, this is an example of one that I wouldn't call modernist, but I would have to say it's timeless. And I mean, the choice of music, Peer Gynt is not a modernist piece. This is their most famous work. But I just think that this is one of those, like some of Rufus and Margot's finest work. This is just a timeless piece of sculpture. I don't care whether it's modernist or not modernist. It's just a really gorgeous puppet. That's from Peer Gynt, too. These little imps are a little bit more on the modernist side. And when I went through the Beaumont book from 1938, they did advertising stuff. And I think actually the ones up above are by a British puppeteer, but I think it's these two down here that are Tatterman puppets that were used for commercial advertising purposes, and that's certainly along the modernist line. And 1936, this was a WPA project in New York, and this horse is by Daubert. The next year, he did a fellow named Orson Welles directed a show called Marlowe's Dr. Faustus, and the Seven Deadly Sins were done by Bill Baird, and he met a young woman who was a dancer in this show named Cora, and soon after they married. But this was a year before that. And there's Mr. Baird with one of his modernist puppets. And this is quite a bit later, but I would say modern. This is from the 1964 World's Fair. But this is very different than the Sard style. This is very different than, in a visual sense, than the kind of puppet. And I want to finish with a bunch of round heads that are, again, not in that European classical tradition. And Kukulu was sculpted in 1936. The story was that Bert Tilstrom, who was 19 years old, came to the first puppet festival in 1936 in Chicago and went home and made Kukulu. And so he dates back to 36. So we're looking at a circle there, right? And another circle with a nose. And here's another circular puppet head. This is George Lackshaw's Wilbur, done in the early 50s. I don't know the date of these circles. This is Obratsov. I'm not sure. I didn't geek out enough to find the date of those.
It's early 19th century.
Yeah. Well, he started his career in the 30s, I think, actually. Or his puppet. He may be in the 20s, but then he had his...
When he was an actor in Moscow Art Theater,
yeah.
Right? He would make puppets to learn his roles. So.
Yeah. And then finally, here's another round-headed puppet. So that there's a thread of the modern style of design that started back then with maybe with Kukulu or maybe with Obratsov and goes straight through to Rolf.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you very much. I don't know if Bart has respondences to...
Not so much, although I do want to go back to something, someone that we've highlighted twice now. A woman from the Cleveland Playhouse, Helen Hyman Joseph, is renowned for writing the first American book on puppetry. And the given date is 1920, but I actually have a copy from 1919.
Yes, and of course, it was thanks to her that George Lackshaw got into puppetry. So I'd just like to expand a little bit on someone or on a company that's been mentioned by both John and Steve, and that is the Yale Puppeteers, who had a number of different theaters, including the most famous, I guess, was the Turnabout Theater in West Hollywood that ran from 1941 to 1956, I believe. But Forman and, actually, I began researching him because of his poetry, not his puppetry. This is a young Forman about the time he was at the University of Michigan studying writing with Robert Frost. He started there in 1919, and he was living with a cousin named Harry Burnett, who became one of the other founders of the Yale Puppeteers. They started, even as teenagers, touring marionette shows in the summertime, inspired by Tony Sark. And eventually, Forman started to pursue a career in poetry, or academic poetry, while Harry went to the newly formed Yale Drama School, and several times was being threatened with being thrown out because of his interest in puppets, and he wasn't paying enough attention to legitimate theater. But that's where he met Roddy Brandon, who became the third. They prevailed upon Forman to quit his academic career and join them as a puppet company, and because Forman was quickly enamored of Roddy, certainly one of the reasons he agreed, and there began a company back in the mid-1920s that continued in some form well into the kind of 70s before they really were more or less retired, but they were still performing at their home, which was a large place out in Los Angeles that they could bring people into for Sunday afternoon shows. That went on for a long time. Here's an idea of what Turnabout was like. This was the opening number. You can see there, leaning on the lamppost, is Elsa Lanchester. She worked with them for the first about 12 years of the company. And she was, of course, married to Charles Laughton, had a background in cabaret from England. And she saw Foreman as a man who could write songs that were really suited to her talent. So the thing about Turnabout is that it started with a Marionette Review, and I think this might be something we consider modernist about them. As you mentioned before, they started stripping away some of the scenery that was there to mask the puppeteers, so that they were both performing as people, and the puppets were performing at the same time. So that may have been an influence on some of the cabaret style acts that came afterwards. But they would do this puppet review, and then people would leave the theater, go out onto the patio for coffee and cakes. When they came back in, people would flip the backs of their chairs because they were all taken from old trolley cars, and now they'd be facing the other end of the theater. So as Foreman would say, if you were seated at the front in the first act, now you'll be at the back, and vice versa, because Turnabout is fair play. And then they would do an acting review, as you can see in that picture. And one of the other people there, the very diminutive woman near Foreman, who's at the piano, was Lotta Goslar. She was famous in Europe as a kind of comic mime dancer before Marcel Marceau had even made a name for himself. She worked for them for a number of years. And so let me just run through a couple of these. Anyway, he was both a puppeteer, and he wrote all the lyrics and music for the shows. So there's Elsa, looking very glamorous. Here is Foreman at the piano, getting into middle age. One of his two books of poetry from his early years, where he remained a good friend of Robert Frost. Here's Harry. Now, Harry was listed by Steve as one of the Americans who went to Europe. He studied with the masters in Czechoslovakia, Italy, Austria, France. I mean, not studied, but he went and visited. He learned what he could from them. And just a couple of pictures. There they are in the early years. The boys, as they were called, lived together and worked together from the mid-20s all the way until the end of their lives. And Foreman and Harry both lived into their 90s. Died in 1996. Foreman, he was the last of them. Here they are in that first summer theater they had up in New Hampshire, the Tallyho Theater, just a couple of miles from Robert Frost's farm. It was a farm that Foreman bought and maintained up there for 14 years. Frost Place. Norman Bel Geddes, talk about modernism. This is the man who's probably as responsible as anyone for the look of American modernism. He designed buildings for the World's Fair. He designed sets for Broadway and other theaters around the country. He was an industrial designer. And he also designed the sets for one of the first big touring shows of the Yale puppet. Oh, that's not it, is it? Do I have that? He designed two shows for the Yale Puppeteers. Very modern, very almost useless for a puppet company, but he wanted to try his hand at puppet design. So there are some of their portrait puppets that Harry used to do when they knew that celebrities would be coming to the theater. Martha Graham, with whom Harry studied when he was at Yale. I think you know this guy. And let's see, there's the book that Foreman put out the novel under the name Richard Meeker. And finally, in its when it was published in paperback, in its third printing, he identified himself to the publisher as the actual author of it, and he was finally out at age 86, and he never looked back. Just a few more. That's outside the Turnabout Theater. The boys with their marionette review. And here are the seats from Turnabout. The seats each had names. Gilbert Sullivan, Bread and Butter, Gin and Bitters, because they seated two people at each one. So they didn't have numbers on them. You had to find the name of your seat. There's Harry as the back end of the horse.
Oh, no.
Oh, there he is. Sorry. Elsa again, looking beautiful, and in her one of her many character roles in the songs that Foreman wrote for her. Another member of the company, Odetta, got her start there. There's Lotta in costume. This was after Turnabout, but she continued to play the impish child well into her 80s. And she cut quite a figure. I saw her perform. So there they are. And here is the wall where there were one of four panels where celebrities would sign their name at Turnabout. They still exist, though there's only one that is still visible. Anyway, one of the things that strikes me with a modernist connection is that, I mean, Brecht is really the guy for me who ushered in modernism in 20th century theater. And that stripping away of the, you know, the trappings of the sets and things that sort of masked what theater was really about, exposing the machinery of it, that's all there in puppetry, which are puppets are kind of naturally distancing in the way that Brecht used that kind of distancing or Verfremdung effect. And while Turnabout was going, of course Charles Laughton would come to the theater every night, at least afterwards, to sit with everybody and just kind of hang out after the shows. And during part of that time, Bertolt Brecht was living with Charles and Elsa at their house while the two men were working on Galileo. So, just a little interesting kind of note about that.
And he went to see Turnabout.
Yes, and he went to see Turnabout. Elsa thought he was a dreadful man. They smoked cheap cigars and stank up their house, is what she said. But there you have it.
Great. Thank you.
Sure.
Responses or comments some by Mr. Rocco Burton, and then we can have a conversation with all of you.
I was going to say we should open it up.
Oh, okay. That would be awesome. Questions, comments? Yes, right?
This is maybe a weird question, but the idea of puppetry modernism and the American style of puppetry, this being the inception of a uniquely American style of puppetry, obviously, now we have so many very diverse influences influencing American puppetry. What would you say are the defining features of American puppetry today? Like, what have we retained from our origins, and how are we still like that?
Good question. So are we postmodern?
Are we post-postmodern?
Yeah. I mean, I think we are because, you know, we're in an era where we kind of done modernism, and now, I mean, people are pulling stuff from all different eras and mixing it together.
And cultures.
And cultures, yeah. I mean, everything now is at your fingertips. When I started researching stuff, texts, and they were hard to find. And now it's like, I mean, you know, I'm sure you're in a class and you have students who have the answer on their phone before you even get to the next slide. And on the other hand, a lot of people do go through these programs. They learn about the history. They know they're standing on the shoulders of giants. So there's definitely traditional influences, but there's so many different things. Yes.
The breakaway from the well-made play, the sort of drawing room comedy and that kind of theater, was one of the breaking away from that was one of the modernist things. So you have somebody like Buffano doing Oedipus Rex. So going back to the origins of theater as ritual, going back to theater that is not as realistic, that it's more sort of epic in scale, and looking at the theater of other cultures. So all that was started in those days with people like Buffano. And that carries right through to somebody like Julie Taymor, who looked at African traditions. One of the things of looking at other cultures that's been a huge influence in American puppetry is people looking at Baraku from Japan. But that idea of looking outside the European tradition kind of, I think, started back then in the 30s in the modernist era. So I think that's something that's been brought forward. And even like rod puppets, I mean, you could really say really rod puppets began in Indonesia. That was the real origin. But as I was talking about Marjorie Batchelder doing rod puppets, and you know, I wasn't kidding when I said they're the great-great-great-grandparents of the Muppets. So that particular style, which is most identified American form today around the world, really does have some roots back in those days. You know, and Jim Henson was very aware of those people. He was very influenced by Bert Tilstrom, who started in the 30s. He was very good friends with Rufus and Margot Rose. And so he took some of those ideas and brought them forward, and certainly his work is one of the distinguishing things in puppetry today.
What is interesting about Marjorie Batchelder's book, Rod Puppets and the Human Theater, this book is all research. She had intended to actually go to Southeast Asia and experience the actual forms, and this thing called World War II started. And so this book, which is a thick book, really well researched and well presented, is actually just research, yet she learned from herself and started performing with Rob.
I wanted to say that, but as I was saying at the outset, but the way I'm thinking of modernism is not so much as a particular artistic style that involves abstraction and some of the beautiful kinds of things that, well, like you can see in the Calder geometric figures from Socrate there, or the futuristic figures from in Verity, but really a way of life that draws on traditional forms, like what we were talking about, European marionettes and hand puppets, for example, but then takes in and responds to all of these new influences, like the Asian forms of puppetry in our case, or new technologies involving transportation or film and television, and making it all work, you know, inventing new ways to perform, inventing new techniques of performance. And I think that happens today when you look at like puppet art students who are involved with digital animation or stop motion animation or other aspects of the digital communication that's going on. And I think the way that like you're involved with mascot performance, which is this hugely popular form of mask and costume performance that people do in all sorts of different contexts all over. By the way that Kevin Marinelli is using computer technology to create mechanical operations for marionettes. I think that spirit of working with the old and then applying to new contexts is, in a way, the continuity of modernism. Other questions, comments? So is it too nerdy or geeky? Enough? Yes.
One of the things that I find really wonderful about the whole art form is that it does seem to tap right into the, you know, basic talking about Freud, you have a feeling that no matter what the product, there's always the potential for trouble. There's always the potential for the id to come out, the life force, whether it's going to be for good or for evil, and it's and often also ambivalence. And I wondered if that's one of the things that makes puppetry so compelling in today's world also, and make means that there that it will always be around, that there'll be even technologies, that there will be because of its the fundamentals of it.
Go ahead, Bart.
I'm gonna respond in a very different direction. I personally believe, and you have to just go with me on this because I'm a puppeteer and have an imagination. I personally believe that puppets were our, as humans, were our first gods and our first demons. That they were used by people who were gathering together in tribes to support each other to explain nature. And so I think it's part of the human need for puppetry that will continue going on,
mm-hmm.
as well as all the spectacular things that are taking place today. So sorry for going back a little ways.
I think part of the reason that puppets appealed to so many people beginning in the late 19th century with people like Craig, but then going through all of the different modernist movements or elements that Steve talked about is that it's this form of communicating with things, objects, materials, images, rather than text and rather than the realistic, you know, enacting recitation and representation of human characters. But like the geometric shapes that Steve talked about as a through line, or you know, Calder saying, "Okay, I made my sculpture of the camel in Paris, and now there's going to be a show with a rectangle, a red circle, and this sphere made out of pipe, you know, and that's going to be what you see." Or as Paulette Richards, who's the co-curator of our African American exhibit coming up in October, writes about Henson and sort of the history of swamp figures as signifiers of race in Southern culture, in American culture. The Muppets that Henson develops, because they are green and brown and yellow and blue rather than, say, black and white, representing white folks and African Americans, because they go into this more abstract realm, they're able to connect in all sorts of ways that are quite useful, one could say. So turning to that language of images, which, you know, well, you know, if we can make puppets out of objects, so what is the almost empty water bottle mean? You know, makes that sound. You know, like, what does that mean? You know, we could say, well, that's Hamlet, or it's Hope Hicks coming home to Greenwich, or it's whatever. You know, like you can do that because it's an object. It's whatever you want it to be. So I think that's always appealing. And going back to what Bart was saying about puppets being the original, you know, gods, you know, I think that's probably right, you know, that they leave, okay, what is that thing? It's a piece of wood. Well, no, it's, you know, Shunley or whatever, Ogun, you know, a Yoruba god or a Native American god or a crucifix. There's a friend tonight is doing a presentation at Yale about medieval puppetry and about crucifixes, animated crucifixes in medieval times, because, you know, like, that was an image that people could connect to at a time when people weren't reading a lot. You know, all the stuff in those churches and cathedrals was highly imagistic performance.
Could I just say, getting back to that idea of are we postmodern, or thinking of the last two puppet festivals I was at last summer, you know, what was I seeing? Among invented theater, there was also Hamlet, there was Macbeth, there was a Ubu, all done in the wildest ways, I mean, that I hadn't imagined. Dramatic, but also hilarious. combining techniques of mime and musical theater and puppetry, object manipulation. So that is a kind of postmodern condition, you know, this mixing of eras and styles and coming up with something new. Maybe postmodernism is the next forum, next year or something.
You know, I think it seems to me that in some ways, thinking about this whole modernism thing, that in a lot of ways puppetry is almost beyond category, or naturally smashes boundaries and categories. What I didn't mention when I was talking about the beginning of Cubism was one of Picasso's inspirations was African masks. And while I was talking about the European tradition of carved puppetry and realistic puppets, if you think about it, Mr. Punch and all his cousins are anything but realistic. Those are not realistic faces. And although they came out of that era when all that pretty stuff was around that the modernists were rebelling against, Punch is really not part of that tradition. He's very bold. He's a caricature. There's that. That's not the face you would see walking down the street, or at least I hope not. And he was inspirational. So that tradition is a third tradition in puppetry too, of breaking those boundaries. And we're talking about women. Puppetry also crosses gender. I wrote a piece a long time ago about puppeteers naturally don't worry about it that much. Men play women's parts, women plays men's parts. You also get a chance to play dogs, cats, chairs, objects, and give them all voices. And it's just something we naturally do without actually particularly thinking about it, whether the role was intended to be that very simplistic male-female thing. But puppetry, that's not a big deal one way or the other.
Yes?
I have a question. If you quickly went through about 90 years of puppets in your collective wildest imaginations, do you have any thoughts on what the next 90 years might look like?
That's a question for the students.
Probably a lot of digitization, a lot of blending of digital and material forms. That seems to be where a lot of it's going right now, so I can only imagine it'll get more and more wild with holograms and virtual reality.
There's going to be a concert at the Jorgensen Center of a digital, three-dimensional digital image, an avatar of Maria Callas with a live orchestra singing. There's a review of this performance in the New York Times a couple of months ago, but it's, you know, it's kind of along the lines of what you're talking about.
Right. Well, would you consider holograms to be puppetry?
Depends on how they appear.
Yeah.
If it's an image that is taken from a camera, if I'm filming John and it's appearing over here, I don't call that a puppet. But if it's an image that I'm animating to appear over here, then yes, it's a puppet.
The thing I think about is when Andy Serkis first started performing Gollum in the first Lord of the Rings and was doing motion capture, so as he moved, the digital image of Gollum moved, right? Because of the sensors on his body, the Mexican puppeteer who was sort of leading him through this new technology said, "Think about it as puppet theater, you know, as digital puppet theater." And philosophically, certainly, you know, this idea that you know I move my hand and this figure moves, or I move my body and the thing moves, is very much along the lines of what happens in motion capture, I would say. And there's lots of overlap, you know, technologically speaking, with like the Henson company inventing this Waldo mechanism for controlling analog puppets and digital puppets. There's a lot of overlap with puppeteers working in film and stop motion animation and that digital stuff. So it's an interesting question, like, is it a puppet or not? But I think for me, it's like the process of it, the idea of moving humans moving objects, you know, which could be light or it could be digital projection, you know, it's kind of the same area as opposed to like acting. Acting is a different job where you're embodying a character with your own body. You know, for, if you're on film, you're still an actor, but to work with images and to make the images move, is there's a continuity there.
But I think it, for me, an important element to this is the engagement of the audience. We as performers, puppeteers, can only take an object and move it in a certain way and add sound to it. We have to engage your imagination to help us create the illusion of life in that object. So if we can't get you engaged, it's a waste of both of our times. So that is very much part of it. This sets up a question, a very different argument if you're talking about film or television, where the audience is not in the same studio or in the same space. But I personally feel that live puppetry, live puppet performance, has a future because, again, human need. And there's something different about being in the same space and breathing the same air as you're performing.
There's an interesting essay I recommend to you by Stephen Kaplan, UConn Puppet Arts grad, called A Puppet Tree. That talks about the relationships between various forms of traditional puppetry and the use of more technological fields and how they're all related. It's quite
a puppet tree.
A puppet tree. It's a play on words.
Like a
puppet
family tree.
Puppetry. T-R-E. Comments, questions. In the world of the interwebs, are there questions? No. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
This is just a point of clarification. You mentioned, I think it was you, John, when you mentioned Midsummer Night's Dream, and you said rude mechanicals. Now, I only know that term from the current avant-garde theater group based in Austin.
Yep.
But I don't know the roots of it. So did you mean when you said rude mechanicals back then, were you referring to the group or the puppets themselves?
Well, in Midsummer Night's Dream, the working class guys who perform the play about the Pyramus and Thisbe, are referred to as rude mechanicals. I think they're mechanicals because they work with their hands. So it's a term that Shakespeare uses. And with von Valkenburg, when she got interested in doing Midsummer Night's Dream, she decided to do scenes with fairies because they could fly around, and she thought that was a good use of marionettes. And then I guess she did the Pyramus and Thisbe. Because I guess it lends itself to, there's the ass and there's the lion, and so it doesn't refer to that postmodern Austin-based interesting theater group. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that Tony Sarg worked with the reverse marionettes, worked with the large form floating figures. Was that a form that was invented by Tony Sarg, or does it have a longer history than that?
I'm aware of the use of animal balloons in a musical piece by Darius Milhaud, who was another modernist French composer, in his production of La Création du Monde, the creation of the world. It was supposed to be an African creation myth. Based on the African creation myth, and the idea was that Adam and Eve, human performers, were dancing around on the stage, and while they were dancing, animal hides were being inflated with helium to bounce around the stage with them. But it didn't go too far because the sound of the helium going into the skins was so loud they couldn't hear the orchestra.
I mean, there's some history of inflatables, in Carnival, and an inflated pig splatter was used to you beat people over the head with it, in the Caribbean and in Europe too. But I don't think that was representing characters. So I don't know that it was Sarg who thought of the idea. My sense is that Macy's sent him out to Ohio to Goodyear Rubber, and somebody must have seen the inflatables that were being used by the War Department, by I think the Navy and the Army, right, for those purposes, surveillance purposes, I think above all, and someone, I don't know who, I'm thinking about it, thought, hey, why don't we paint some eyes on it, and so Sarg, right, because he had this sense of object manipulation was able, and this is sort of the essence of what I think of as the modernism of it. He's like, okay, got it. Well, as Steve Abrams' image showed, we'll make characters out of simple, like cylinders. It's pattern making, and noses, and spheres for the heads, and sew them together, or they're probably not sewn, and inflate them with you, and that'll be a character. So it wasn't, as far as I know, it was a brand new technology for puppets, and you know, and it's extraordinarily well known and popular around the world. You know, it's a ritual performance every year. So, it would be interesting to know if it was his idea or somebody else in Macy's who thought of it. But I think I hadn't known that what Bart mentioned, but I don't think there was a strong history of inflatables beforehand.
And the one I'm mentioning was animal skins.
Yeah, rubber. Like whatever latex, you know, that material. What do you do with that material? Other questions and comments, brilliant thoughts, half-baked notions. Okay. Well, good. Yes. Oh yeah. Please, Bart.
Okay. Many of you knew Jerry Rojo, and I don't want to end this on a sad note tonight, but Jerry passed away 2 days ago, and. Joanne Padavina, Tom, John Nolan are here. We want to celebrate Jerry's life. Tom, Joanne and I spent the whole morning today looking at Jerry's 10-page resume in 9-point font, single-spaced. Okay, and trying to figure out how to announce or to let the world know of his passing and of his gifts. Jerry was very important to us here at the University of Connecticut. He taught here from 1960 through 1990. Well, he was a professor from 1960 to 1990, but he never left us. He stayed with us, and many of my students know him. He worked with us on productions. He attended rehearsals. He was here at the Forum, our last Forum, several weeks ago. So we've lost him, but we haven't lost what he gave us. So. We will be announcing a memorial sometime very soon.
When I think of Jerry, I think I first was aware of his set designs for at the Performing Garage. The performance group in the 60s was one of the dynamic, radical, avant-garde theater companies, and they did shows like Dionysus in 69, which is kind of a landmark production directed by Richard Schechter. And Jerry designed this multi-leveled environmental scenery where the audience and the performers were mixed and there were different, another aspect of that is the Mobius Theater across the street here, parts of it. And as Bart said, Jerry was a huge supporter of puppetry. He, coming to our events, coming to the puppet slams, as well as working closely with many puppet art students. The thing that I think about in terms of him and this modernism is that he was a theater person that more or less worked with, you know, actors and performers, but in a brand new way, this idea of environmental theater where we're mixing it up, theater is approaching ritual in that 60s way, but also he was very open to and interested and supportive of puppetry, which is actually in some cases rare. There are some people, you know, a sizable number of theater people who don't want to have anything to do with anything other than actors. You know, it's I think that's changing, but you know, the real art form is we're acting and Leo's another actor and the audience watches us and we're reciting the David Mamet text. But other people, like all the people we've been thinking about, the little theater movement, all those folks are like, oh, puppets. Yeah, why not? That'd be great. Let's try it out. Let's see what could happen. And that spirit, which I think is in a way the essence of modernism, let's try out that new technology. Let's try out that new way of defining actor space and performer space. You know, yeah, let's build a stage that's all these different levels and, you know, like Jerry did. Now that's really brilliant and really modernist and really forward-looking and opening itself up to the possibilities and not saying, what we're dealing with is a narrowly defined art form which we must pursue in a straight line, but instead being open. And that's one of the things I loved about Jerry Rojo. So we're really lucky.
Thank you, John.
Yeah. So, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.